By the blood of the Lamb, we come to you, Father. We enter into the holies of holies. By the blood of Christ Jesus, Father, we stand with boldness before you now. Almighty God, we thank you that this offering is by fire. Oh God, our holy God, we thank you for your spirit. We thank you, Father, now for this Holy Ghost and power. We thank you, Father, now for your glory all around. Oh, fire, of the fire of the Lord, the rivers are the rivers of our God. We worship you with joy and rejoicing, Lord. We worship you with praise and thanksgiving. We worship you, by the Holy Ghost. We worship you, by the Spirit and by truth. Oh, we thank you for your joy and for your rejoicing. Oh, God, we thank you for your praise and for your thanksgiving. We worship you with joy and with rejoicing of heart.
Yes, Lord.
We worship you, oh God, in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Filled to overflowing. By the Holy Ghost and power, be filled with the Holy Spirit and speak to yourself in songs. Be filled with the Holy Spirit and speak the spiritual songs. Oh, be filled with the Holy Spirit and begin to sing the hymns. Oh, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Let praise and truth begin. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. I begin to sing the songs. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. And let the hymns begin. Oh, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Oh, and sing the spiritual songs. Sing the spiritual song. Yo, Mandea. Zela Zera, Mamanda, Lalandera, Omnisiel, Lalando, Lossin, and the name of Ramondi. Susala, Mamanda, Lalamangila, Lossin, Saram, the Deluk, Sierra, Mambera. Hallelujah. Listen. Just keep going. I just want to try to bring everybody else along, you know. The reality of it is, praise the name of Jesus. Father has brought forth a new creation, something that looks just like Him. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. It's united with Him. It's one with Him. It's filled with Him. We're in Him. He's in us. We're His temple. All His glory overshadows us. It's alongside of us, fills us. People are always wanting to talk about some salvation in the future. I mean, the people got all upset at the Westlands because they had a second work of grace. Pentecostals have third and fourth and fifth works of grace now. So, I mean, the reality of it is God came and by the working of His mighty power responds to a sincere and a true heart and brings forth a new creation, a new man that looks just like Him. And, you know, I was the Lord spoke to me today and He said, you know, people quote John 3:30 like they're in the transition of the covenant. John said, I must decrease, He must I must decrease that he may increase. You see, every way to translate it. He will increase, but I must decrease. That's nonsense. That has nothing to do with us. We're dead. And our life is hid with God in Christ. Somebody needs to get into the covenant. Somebody needs to get raised up together with him. Somebody needs to get alive together with him. You need to get rid of all the doctrines that make you anything less than everything that God's, anything less than God's absolute best. He has brought to us this wonderful new heart, new spirit. In my mind are written all his covenants. He said, this is the new covenant. I will write my laws and my statutes and my judgments upon your mind and your heart. You will do them. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10, Hebrews 10, 16, quoting Ezekiel 36, 26, Jeremiah 31, 33. The list goes on. You just need to get saved here tonight and make no more excuses. If I can teach God's people, and it's one of the things we're dedicated to do tonight, you're in a good place. We can teach God's people how to be filled with the Spirit. You won't want any other spirit. Father has made it available for us to be continually filled with the Spirit. I've asked and been asked many times, what's the difference between being baptized in the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit? Absolutely nothing. The Lord Jesus said, you shall be baptized not many days from now. And they were filled with the Spirit and began to speak. Hallelujah. 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 If you don't know what I just was referring to and just hinted on quoting, I just hinted on quoting Acts 1, 5, 1, 8, Acts 2, 4. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. The messianic age has come. The new age has come. Christ Jesus was crowned 2,000 years ago. We're not waiting. I tell you right now, dear people, I'm living in heaven right now. I'm living in heaven today. I'm seated together within a heavenly place. I'm blessed with all spiritual blessings in a heavenly realm. If they could have it in Deuteronomy chapter 11, what do you think we can have now? All they had then was just the law of the covenants. Today, we've received the new creation, the new man. We've received everything that God has planned. We received that wonderful working of the Holy Ghost where the Spirit of the Lord is in us. We've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, made his temple, his dwelling place. One with him received his glory. I have the righteousness of God. The gift of holiness is mine. People have been born into religion. There are two things. There's two realms. There is the philosophical tradition of the church, and there's the revelation of the word. I have devoted myself only to the revelation of the word. Many people say so, but I can sort it out real quick. Just listen till you talk for 5 minutes. Because there's so much of where we've just either just dedicated ourselves to the philosophical traditions of the church that began with people like Justin Tatian, Origen, Eusebius, Augustine, their list goes on. Or we're going to be over here dedicated to the revelation of the word only. And then there's some people that are just sandwiched in between and they got the mixture of it. But if you just set all that stuff aside and you quit listening to everybody's explanation of words they don't even understand, and just to listen to the simple creation of the new man, being born again, made a new creature, born of the corruptible seed of the word of God that lives and abides forever, being born of the Spirit, made the dwelling place of God where Father has moved the holies of holies into our heart. Hallelujah. And we now have his thoughts filling our understanding, his word in our heart and our mouth, that we may speak it. I mean, come on, people. The whole reason that people have not known how to overcome sin and live the life of the overcomers because they've never understood how to first and foremost agree with God, because that's the foundation of faith. First and foremost, you must agree with God. It's the basis of the word. It's the basis of the context. You must agree with God. When you agree with God, then you trust him that everything he said he's able to do and willing to do and faithful to bring to pass. And then all of a sudden, God breathes on that and causes supernatural activity of the Spirit to happen in our life called faith. Faith is a supernatural ability, empowerment of God to do everything he does. Amen. Starting with speaking to mountains. I mean, you know. Yes, amen. People want to define faith as something other than speaking to mountains and telling them to get out of the way, speaking to sycamine trees and saying, being planted in the sea, speaking forth the word of God and seeing all the things that belong to his authority being revealed in the earth. It's amazing to me that people will recognize and understand that Father has given us the power to turn people from the power of Satan to God, that he's given us the power to turn them from darkness to light, to deliver them from the spiritual blindness, but somehow they don't understand how to appropriate that for their own life. I hear people talk about how they want power over unclean spirits, that God has given them power over unclean spirits, but they don't even have enough ability to say no to some little sin. You need to learn how to be filled with the Spirit. First, let me tell you how easy it is. Start worshiping him. Start telling him how he's almighty, how he's most high, how he's glorious. Listen to how Isaiah talked to him. Listen to how David talked to him. Listen to how Daniel talked to him. Listen, I'm telling you, the greatest revelation of who the Father is found in the book of Isaiah. Over and again, he's describing who God is eternal. God says, there is none besides me. I know of none. Before me, there was none. I am God. There was none created before me, and there should be none created after me. And he goes on and on and on about the revelation of God is, of who God is. And tonight we pray in Jesus' name that you'll get a revelation of who God is. You won't get stuck in religion. If you do not know, listen, I'm going to tell you right now. I hear all these things. The proof of the overcomer, the proof of the believer is the power to be an overcomer. The proof of the believer is to be able to stand against sin. The proof of the believer is to be able to overcome all the works of the devil. I write unto you, young men, because you're strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have defeated Satan at every point. We know that everyone who is born of God does not sin and keeps himself, and the wicked one cannot touch him. Now that's the revelation of the Word of God. The other stuff is the philosophical traditions of the church. There is the pure, simple to understand revelation of the Word of God, unchanging, watched over, kept by the power of God, forever settled in heaven, watching over it to hasten it. This living, this powerful, this spirit, this life, that the eternal word, the logos, the definition, declaration, revelation, proclamation, the essence, the sum total of everything that is, that was ultimately manifested in the flesh, came to model and reveal so that no one can mistake what was written. Hallelujah. We're without excuse. We're without excuse. Tonight, I'll tell you when to quit. Tonight, we're going to display Jesus Christ to you by the power of the Holy Ghost. There is singularly nothing more important in doing that than the ministry of the Word of God. Period. God, the Holy Spirit's not doing anything outside of the Word of God. The rest of it's just a deceiving spirit, lying spirit, should have been a spirit, could have been a spirit, might have been the Spirit, could have been God's grace reaching over top of that place where people weren't listening to what he said. But I'm going to tell you, God, the Holy Spirit genuinely does everything that the Word of God describes. If we'll hear the Word of God, we preach the Word of God till the glory comes. Somebody asked Catherine Coleman one time, they said, why? When there's so many sick and diseased people around and hurting people in pain, you spend so long preaching the word. She said, I'm going to preach the word till the Spirit of the Lord comes. I'm going to preach the word until God the Holy Ghost begins to move. He's going to hover over his word. He's going to brood over the people as God speaks. And I've heard that not only from her, I've heard it over and over again. I'm going to tell you, you need to start speaking the word. People say, well, I don't know, there might be false prophets over there. I'm going to tell you right now, you're the biggest false prophet you've ever met. People are always speaking all kinds of things contrary to the Word of God out of their own mouth. Just start speaking the Word only. Speak the Word only, and you'll walk on the water. Speak the Word only, and you're going to get a multitude of fish. Speak the Word only, I'm telling you right now, and all the majesty and glory and splendor of the Father will be revealed, because the Word was the fullness of Him who filleth all things. The Word of God came in the complete measure and the full dimension of the power of God. And He's here tonight, Jesus. Jesus is aquí. Jesus is here. Hallelujah. We do not want one single person to leave here tonight stuck in anything that this world could try to imprison you with, that the demonic powers would try to deceive you with. All that stuff right now is eliminated. The deceiving, lying spirits of darkness are eliminated. The presence of God is the ability to turn people from the power of Satan to the power of God. The presence of God is here to do that right now, from light to darkness. It's not some supernatural ability, some character thing that we have innately or possess of our own strength. It's just cooperating with the presence of the Lord. And you just come over here into this place in agreement with God's Word, Christ Jesus, God's Word, His written Word that is, hallelujah, in your Bible,
in agreement with the Holy Spirit, things are going to get really good for you. I want you tonight to leave out of this place knowing how to talk to God. I want you to leave out of this place knowing how to talk to the Father. Tell Him how much you love Him, how wonderful He is, how mighty He is, how glorious He is, how all-powerful He is, how He can do anything and everything, how He's brought all things that He possesses to benefit us. God is just so good. We're so blessed tonight to have Pastor Bob Rester and his wife, Debbie Rich Rester, with us. Everybody just praise God for them being with us. Amen. And hallelujah. And Evangelist Debbie is going to bring the word where the pastor intercedes. Hallelujah. And with 100% support, just stands there in agreement. It's good. It's good to have you with us tonight. It's good that you're here. The Spirit of the Lord is moving. Why don't you reach in and grab a hold with your heart, with your passion, with your hunger, with your thirst, the things that have been made available in the house. All of the gifts of the Spirit are in the house.
Amen.
In His house. Don't matter who's there. Because He put them resident there. It just matter. The only difference is who knows how to cooperate with Him, move with Him. Because they're here. He put them in His church. They're here. The word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, the discerning of spirits, the working of miracles, the gifts of healing, the gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues, spirit of wisdom, and revelation. I'm telling you right now, dreams and visions, everything that belongs to the display of revelation and knowledge and doctrine right here, present right now, because God the Holy Ghost is here for the single purpose of revealing and glorifying Jesus Christ. He loves you so much. He paid the huge and ultimate price to redeem you. And how much more, Father, spared not His only Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all. Shall He not also freely give us all things by Him? I tell you, He shall. Bring that down. Everybody, welcome. Welcome. Debbie.
Love you so much. I just had to get that in there.
It's awesome. Hallelujah. 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 Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many came expecting to receive something tonight? How many will say right now, if it's for nobody else in this auditorium, it's for me. It's for me right now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yes. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated.
Hallelujah.
Yes, He is. Yes, He is. King of kings and Lord of lords. Amen and amen. You know, I'm so glad Pastor Mark mentioned my husband. I haven't even had a chance to do that. God has blessed me with the most awesome man on the face of the earth. And I trust probably every wife in here thinks that. But I knew that was coming. But I'm so thankful. When he proposed to me, he said, you will know what it's like to be loved as Christ loves the church. And it was all over right there. It was all over. What woman would not want to submit to and reverence and respect a man who lays down his life for her as Christ did for us? That's so easy. That is so easy, and that's the way God meant for it to be in every marriage, and every marriage to be preaching a message. And I'm so thankful for God's great grace and God's great restoration in my life, and thankful for this rock right here. My husband pastored a church for over 22 years, built 3 churches, and has just been such a godsend and blessing to the body of Christ. And a man that can just sit back while his wife preaches revival and amener. And in fact, I was telling some people tonight, I said, if I can hand my camera over to somebody, I said, I've asked my husband to do that But every time he gets so caught up in the meeting, I mean, he gets caught up in the meeting like it's the first time he's heard me preach. He's like, I'm so sorry, honey. I was so enjoying and so amening and so following where you were. I just completely forgot about the camera. And I said, that is so awesome to have a man of God who doesn't say, oh, well, I've heard her do this before, you know. And he just, so I'm just so thankful that he's here at my side with me. You know, we began a message last night that I said we could pull out any time. And I've reversed the order of this and added to and taken out today, going, well, I think we'll do that tomorrow night. No, I think we'll do it tonight. And I'm just going to follow the leading of the Holy Ghost here. But basically, how many were not here last night? Can I see your hands? Well, it's good to have you tonight. And of course, we can't go back over all that. But we're preaching basically one message. That is, it's time for the church to be the church.
Yeah.
Time for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ to quit playing religious games and apathetic games and little church club games. And what position do I get to hold? And my pals are there and all of that stuff. And let the church become the glorious church without spot or wrinkle, the blood-bought, blood-washed church of the Lord Jesus Christ, walking in great signs and wonders and exploits and holiness and in our authority that we've been given, and take dominion and take the Lamb. And we spent quite a while last night talking about what the world needs to see, and we really just got started on that, and we're going to kind of continue it here. And what I thought I was going to end with, I'm going to go to more directly tonight. And for us to be any of those things that we will probably continue to talk about even into tomorrow night, you have to have that Holy Ghost impartation. And Pastor Mark went up there and was talking about tonight. I thought, oh yeah, that's just what we're going to be talking about. Without being marked by heaven.
Right.
I will never forget a night in Alaska, Barrow, Alaska. Anybody know where that is? It's actually at the top of the world. It's the last city. It's on the Arctic Ocean. In fact, I went walking one day, and when I got back, they said, we're so glad to see you. I was walking along the Arctic Ocean just thinking, this is so cool to be walking on the Arctic Ocean, all frozen over. And when I got back, oh, you're in one piece. You didn't expect I would be? Well, they just captured a big mama polar bear and her cubs walking also in the same spots that you did. And in the Alaskan Arctic, where I was a missionary for 7.5 years and still go up there and hold meetings, you don't see a polar bear. At least this is what they tell me, so maybe I could have run into him that day. You don't see him till you see those black eyes right there, because the snow's blowing, everything is covered in white. And but when I was up in Barrow, Alaska, I will never forget that as I was preaching on some things, there was a reaction there where people just could not see the kind of Holy Ghost impartation. I mean, there were a lot of people being touched, but I'm like, man. And all of a sudden, the lady who was with me, she was older, much older than I was, and she would go with me when nobody else wanted to go. I mean, for some reason, people weren't clamoring to go where you eat things like moose head soup made out of the nostrils of the moose, and Eskimo ice cream, which is nothing but whale blubber with berries in it. And when they can't get the whale blubber, they actually go into town when they can fly into Anchorage or Fairbanks or somewhere, and they buy Crisco, the cans of Crisco grease, and they put berries in that. And those were the awesome delicacies, and many times we had outhouses and honey. Anybody know what a honey bucket is? I don't know that you want me to describe it, but it's basically just a pot to go in the bathroom in some back room of the church with no sewage, no anything. And not everybody was just clamoring, oh, Debbie, can I go with you? It's funny, later on when I was based out of Tampa, many of the students said, can I travel with you? I mean, I'll do your nails, I'll shine your shoes. I'm like, where were these people when I was going to the villages of Alaska? But that particular night, I'm preaching away, and all of a sudden I looked out, and my prayer warrior friend, who would go with me anywhere, and she was half Native Alaskan herself, and all of a sudden I see her leg just starting to just vibrate under the power of the Holy Ghost. And then I just saw her just sitting there in her seat like this, and she always said she didn't want to preach. She wasn't called to preach. She was just called to get behind me and pray. But I saw the Holy Ghost all over her, and I said, "Jean, what is it? Just obey the Holy Ghost." And she took off running through the place. And the next thing I knew, she was just slapping people everywhere. And she was saying, "I brand you in the Holy Ghost." And I'm just like checking all my doctrinal theology, "brand you in the Holy Ghost." I'm like, and all of a sudden, first of all, we're sealed with the Holy Ghost. And anybody, I know your pastor has a ranch, anybody who knows anything about branding that hot fire coming on that skin says you can't ever belong to anybody else. I've marked you. They know your mind. They know that you're supposed to be here. And even though we are sealed with the Holy Ghost, there was an impartation that night. I mean, people were acting like cattle do when they get branded. I mean, just, you know, and there was a Holy Ghost move, and I just let her go. I mean, he was all over that place. But in whatever way he chooses to manifest in your life and on a given meeting or even long term, you have to have a supernatural Holy Ghost encounter, or the result is mere religion every time, and it will never hold out. It has to be a Holy Ghost impartation where you walk different, you talk different. I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but I mean, when Jacob wrestled with the angel, he walked different after that. He walked with a limp. I tell you what, he'll change your name. He'll cause you to walk different. He'll cause you to look different. And if you're going to try to do this out of your head or out of mere religion, you might as well hang it up right now, because that was never meant to be. We have the power of the Holy Ghost all over us, in us, behind us, around us, upon us. That is so very, very, very real. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Hallelujah. So amazing. None like him, none beside him. We've allowed the things of this world to satisfy our hunger. We do that all the time, our spiritual hunger. I said last night, you want more anointing, you got to keep rubbing shoulders with anointed people. And as long as I can remember, I've been so hungry and thirsty. There are other places that weren't our strongest points, but that was one of the strongest right there. Stayed hungry, stayed thirsty. When I was a little girl, and my parents weren't serving God, it was my grandparents that took myself and my little brother, who's also in the ministry, to church every time the doors were open. And I can remember our church had a water fountain at the back. No such thing in those days as water bottles. And if the preacher, the pastor, the evangelist, anybody with this much anointing would walk to the back to get a drink from the water fountain, guess what? Little girl was suddenly thirsty. You know what? I didn't care about the water. It was an excuse to stand close to the preacher. You may think, you've got to be kidding. No, I can feel that anointing. Yeah. And I would say to Grandma and Grandpa, "Can I sit in the front row?" "Why do you want to sit in the front row, honey?" And I said, "Because when I'm sitting up there, I can feel that." I didn't know what the word, I'm talking about 3 and 4 and 5. I didn't know the word anointing. I can feel that. Yeah. I can feel that. And they said, "Oh, that must be the anointing you're talking about." And I said, "Must be. I can feel that. I can feel that." And when we would go out to lunch, and I'd be sitting at the kids' table after church, you know, or the teenagers' table when I was older, and I would have one ear over at the preacher's table and the adults' table, and my friends would say, "Debbie, why you don't even listen to us? You're trying to listen to the preachers." And I know, I'm sorry. And my cousin's dad was the youth leader in our church and the associate pastor. I would want to go home and stay with her just so I could stay up half the night and ask her dad a dozen questions about the Lord. And she'd say, "Why? You don't even come over here to spend the night with me. You come over here to talk to my father. I know you do." And I went, yeah. Hungry, thirsty, hungry, thirsty. And if you ever get to the point that you think you know it now, that you can let up now, you are done. Because it's those who hunger and thirst after righteousness who shall be, not might be, not if they're sitting in the right seat, not if they just happen to be God's favorite that day. Anybody who hungers and thirsts after righteousness shall be filled. I tell you, it was my hunger and thirst that drew me out of the crowd in Alaska that caused Pastor Rodney to recognize me and pull me up front. I'm not going to go into the detail, but there were people trying to get me to go up and talk to him. I still remember it. They go, well, go up and talk to him after the meeting. Tell him you're having services like he is, because the joy had just started falling all over Alaska, the villages and the prison ministry that I had going on, and the little church that we were pastoring at that time. I said, and the point being what? Why would I walk up to a man and say, I'm having these kind of meetings too? I mean, even if there was a point to it, he would look at me like, yeah? Uh-huh. I said, I'm not going to do that. Oh, Debbie, you need to. And then they are the ones, some close friends of mine said, you've got to go. You've got to go to this minister's luncheon that he announced he was having, only he called it Apostles' Luncheon. And I thought to myself, I just resigned my church. And I had announced that I was going all over the world. Now, I had a totaled car, 3 boys raised by myself, not a dime to my name, and I announced I'm going all over the world now. And people are like, yeah, and maybe I would have waited a minute to mention that. Maybe at least till you got another car that didn't have 3 doors and the roof and the grill all smashed in. And so when he said pastor's luncheon, I thought, I'm not even any longer a pastor. I've just resigned. I'm going out. I better not go. And they said, no, I think he just uses that word for minister's luncheon, which I found out was indeed true. But I didn't want to go. I said, I'll be the only one there alone. I'm not married. All these other people will be in couples. And you know, I've just been through a lot, and people know that. And oh, I don't want to go sit there by myself. I don't know these other people. It's into Anchorage. I'm already driving an hour and 45 minutes to the meetings each way, every night, over icy roads in the middle of the winter in Alaska. And now let's add on another meeting. I got to go alone. Don't know these people. But they said, no, you need to go, Debbie. You don't ever get any fellowship. Okay, I'll go. Now, what I've not told you, and some of the people that remember me from years ago and probably heard my testimony, just 2 weeks before that, this isn't in my notes, by the way, every night I love what the Holy Ghost, who needs this? 2 weeks before that, another minister had come to Alaska, and I was invited to attend the meeting. He was preaching. It was wonderful. It was anointed. It was great. And then these pastors said, Debbie, go out to eat with us afterwards. And so I did. And I asked him a couple of questions, practical questions, about plane tickets, not about should I be in the ministry, should I be an evangelist, just, hey, mister, I didn't say mister, hey, sir, you've been going all over the world. I said, I want to ask you some things about plane tickets, because I'm having to start buying a lot of them here in Alaska. And I asked him a couple of practical questions. He said, I'm not under the anointing right now. I'm not prophesying. At least, thank God he said that. He said, I'm just giving you my opinion. I've heard what's happened to you, what's happened to your family. He said, yeah, I know I've never heard you preach or anything, but forget it. You're not called. He said, I think you're just trying to copy somebody, and you just need to go back to wherever you grew up in Nebraska and take those 3 sons of yours back home and let them be around grandparents and just forget this whole idea, okay? His little okay was like I fell off a 20-foot building and got the wind knocked out of me. I'd just been in his meeting. He was anointed. He said some powerful stuff. I mean, so if he's anointed there and he's telling me now to forget it, and I've always had this respect for every man of God from the time I was this high and thought they couldn't even ever step out of the anointing at that time. And I was just like, I couldn't even breathe. I couldn't say anything. But I went back to where I was. This couple that was helping me get started in the ministry, I went back and got a hold of them, and they said, look, yes, he's anointed in the meetings. He told you he was no longer under the anointing. He wasn't prophesying. He was just giving his opinion. He's heard something. He's going on hearsay. He's never seen you minister. Listen, the first time you walked in our little church, we saw the anointing like we've never seen it. We turned to each other and said, this lady's going all over the world, and we're going with her. And they said, you go to our house, you take the phone off the hook. That's back in the days we had that time. And you take the phone off the hook. We're not going to tell anybody where you are. And you get a hold of God. I did. God did. The rest is history. I wrote down and even spoke into a tape recorder. I have that tape somewhere today. So many things that have already come to pass today that looked so impossible at that moment. But thank God I got a hold of God. And so now 2 weeks later, here I am at this pastor's luncheon that I didn't want to go to. Pastor Rodney Howard Brown is just being funny. He's telling funny stories. He's eating a chicken leg. He's joking around. He's not doing anything very spiritual. And he points at me and he goes, "Lady, you." And I looked at the lady beside me. She's looking at me. I look at the one on this side. She's looking at me. I went, "Me? Yes, you." I thought, oh no, here we go. I mean, one of the things, this man, the other man 2 weeks before that, prior to that, one of the things he had said when he told me to forget it, he says, "I'll give you three reasons you got to forget it. You are a woman, first of all." And I've said so many times, I wish I would have got up and went to a mirror and went, "Oh my goodness, I am, I forgot." Thank God for revelation when we forget important things. You know, I never even thought about that I am. He said, "Number two, you have no husband." Again, it was not deep revelation for me. I was like, oh, I thought I had 10 of them sitting back at the house. Thank God you reminded me. I wanted to say all those things. And then, but it got deeper than that. Number three, the reason you cannot do what you think God has called you to do is because Alaska is very cold. And I thought to myself, here's a man who doesn't even live here. I'm living here. He comes up to do some king salmon fishing, as many people do who go to Alaska, and say, "Boy, if I preach once or twice in a church, I could pay for my king salmon." Exactly. And I'm going where it's 60 degrees below zero, laying on village floors, and we're not going to go into all those stories tonight. And now I need somebody to come up from what Alaskans call the lower 48 states and say Alaska's cold. Well, okay. What if I would have never had that appointment that day? I would have never known I was a woman. I would have never known I didn't have a husband. And I thought I was in the tropics till I had revelation come to me. But that still devastated me. Now, 2 weeks later, when Pastor Rodney goes, "Lady, you." And they're going, "He's talking to you." I'm like, "Yes." My first thought was, "I know. I'm a woman. I don't have a husband. Alaska's cold." I was just bracing myself for it. Only now it was going to come in a South African accent. And I'm just like, "Yes." He goes, "I don't care who came to Alaska just a few weeks ago and discouraged you. God has sent me here to tell you that you have an international ministry all over the world, and everything he told you as a child, he's still going to do. And that just because somebody else is no longer in the picture that should have been and could have been, but chose another way, does not negate the call of God in your life." And he began to prophesy everything I had already written down when I got a hold of God 2 weeks before. But now, as I've said to people, if you're going to depend, thank God for prophetic utterance, and thank God for the gift of prophecy, and thank God for the word of wisdom, and thank God for the word of knowledge. And we're never going to, despite those things, how precious and how important they are to the church. But if I've got to depend on that to have my leading of the Holy Ghost, I've had one man of God who was in his service, it was anointed, say, "Forget it." I've had one man of God who was anointed and I was in his service, say, "Go for it." What am I going to have to do now? Find a church in Las Vegas and take two out of three? But when the Holy Ghost is all over you and you're sensitive to him and he's marked you and he's branded you, then nobody, no devil from hell, no man, no woman, no government, no president, no dictator can take that from you. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not the direction I thought we were starting in. But it's time to rise up and know what you're called to do. Right. And go and flow and run and not back up and not stop and not play with it and not flirt with the world and not be in and out. And then, "Well, Pastor, I realize I'm going to say I'm coming back." No, there is a time to go. No more of that. When I was a child, I thought as a child. But when I grew up, I thought as a man or a woman. And I'm running after you, God, with everything within me. And I'm never looking back. Hallelujah. Yeah. So, we allow the things of the world to satisfy our hunger. I'm glad I've always hung out with hungry people. And I love hanging out with your pastor, some of the hungriest of the hungriest. And it provokes me. And I'm just going to say this. I'm sure my friend and my pal and my co-evangelist, Richard Moore, wouldn't mind me saying this. But he and I, for so many years, were Pastor Rodney's two associate evangelists. We did a lot of ministry together. We even, the first time we came here together with him and then stayed on afterwards. And I've always respected him and respected his giftings and all of that. But I saw him last year and I said to my husband, Richard is another man. Who is this man I'm listening to? I mean, I always respected his gifts before, but I mean, it went from here to off the charts. And I'm going, and then I asked him to come to our church and it continued. And I kept going, and I had to ask him about it. You know what he said? Been hanging around Pastor Mark. He did. He said, I'm on a journey. I'm on a quest. You know what makes me want to cry? I could see the fire burning in his eyes. I'm on a quest to know God and love God like I've never known him or loved him. I'm on a quest to walk in holiness like I've never walked in holiness. And I could feel that radiating from him. And then when your pastors came to Bremerton, Washington, and we went there, I went, you know, I've been around them for years, but I never got to be under their ministry. I mean, I came here and ministered, and one of the times they were gone, and at Pastor Rodney's, I didn't get to hear them except sit with them and fellowship with them. And I just went, oh, this explains a lot of things. This explains what I'm seeing in Richard. This explains what I'm seeing in the pastors here in Bremerton. This explains how anybody that gets close to this ministry comes away going, I live for one thing alone. And I just began to cry out, God, I want this too. And it's not like I was sitting around just twiddling my fingers and not loving the Lord. But I've got to rub shoulders some more. I've got to rub shoulders some more. Amen. And our whole church has begun to say that. But I'm going to tell you something about Brother Richard since I'm on the subject. How many here have heard him give his testimony about, I don't even want to say it in case. Anyway, yes, his testimony. I have probably heard him try to give that.
Right.
I think I'm safe to say I've probably heard him try to give that hundreds of times over the years. Never heard him get it out yet. But over the years, talking to Pastor Rodney and the interpretation Pastor Rodney does while he's trying to do it, you can start to piece some things together. But for those of you who may not know, this is a man that when he talks about the night that the fire touched, or the morning, afternoon, whatever it was, now I sound like him. Anyway, whatever. When he goes to tell it, Pastor Rodney will say, Richard, tell him about the day the fire came on you. And he'll try, he'll go. He always starts out, us. And Pastor Rodney will go, you, Richard, it was you. Okay, because the fire's already coming on him just like it did that day as soon as he starts. So so we've got that much figured out. Finally, we figure out it was him he's talking about. And then he'll say, it was the summer. It was 94. No, it was the winter of nine. No, it was the fall. And Pastor Rodney will go, nobody cares. Nobody cares when it was. Just, okay, so we get past that finally. That takes a while. But when we get past that, we finally end up here where every time, tell them what happened, Richard. Just tell them what happened. And by, you know, he's got red hair naturally. Well, it's a little more gray these days, but you see his face turn as red as his hair used to be, and he's just stuck on the F. The f, 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 f. And Pastor Rodney will have to get up and go, fire! Mm. And that's how the whole, now I've seen him, I've seen his whole body go stiff, where two ushers have to come and put a hand under each fist and carry him off like that. I've seen him take off running. That's his only release. He's just running fire. And I've seen him where he goes into other tongues and he thinks he's in English. You can tell he thinks he is. He's just telling the whole story. And I've seen him do a lot of things, but I've never heard him tell the story. What? And that is, when you've had the Holy Ghost on you like that, and you relive it, and you step back there, you're just gone again, and that same experience is engulfing you. Now, I've told plenty of my own, and that has happened. I've told Richards in a lot of places, but of course it never happened to me, so I always could tell it fine, kind of like I just did, until one night in Oregon City, Oregon, I go to tell what happened, and we were having a camp meeting that was just, that was a camp meeting of any of the camp meetings I've had, and I think we could have gone on months there, but we didn't. But this particular night, I'm trying to give Richard's testimony, and all of a sudden, I think I'm just imitating him like I just did, only I got to and I felt like I was on fire, and I'm like, no, I'm not Richard. And I'm trying to get it out, and all of a sudden the pulpit started shaking, and all these ushers come up to get behind me, and they all fall out, and I'm still, the pulpit's still shaking, and I'm trying, and I'm like, oh my goodness. And the pastor sees that, he knows I'm going to go down, so he comes up to prepare to take over, and he hits the floor. Now we got the ushers, we got the pastor, we got this dog pile there somewhere, and the last thing I remember is being on the floor, somewhere in the middle of that. And while I'm on the floor, this is what I hear. A scream permeating the entire room. And I hear the footsteps of somebody running. And I hear, my blind eyes just came open. The next thing I heard, my deaf ears just came open. The next thing I hear from the floor, somebody says, my cancerous tumor just went. I'm not doing anything. I'm on the floor going, go, Holy Ghost, go. Nobody's saying anything. Nobody's doing anything. But it was a night I stepped over, highly unusual, in somebody else's Holy Ghost touch that came all over me. What can one touch do after God got me out of the way, which was probably what it was all about? The Holy Ghost began to do the most incredible miracles through that house. I didn't get up till the end of whatever all of that was taking place all night, that great healing and miracle service. And when I did, the pastor's wife said, Debbie, can you come to the back? We were supposed to dedicate somebody's child in the back tonight after the meeting. And she said, can you come back there and help my husband? I said, sure. And when I went back there, her husband was draped over the couch in their nice office place back there. He's draped over it. And he's like, woo, what a night. And his wife said, honey, we got to dedicate a baby. And he's like, what's a baby? And she said, Debbie, can you do it? And I said, I was kind of still in the same place. Baby, be blessed. All of you be blessed. You're dedicated. But what a night in the glory. But even some people here who know some of the things that we've kind of walked out since we've been here, some have said to me, even this very day, some have said, you know what's been an inspiration is that you keep going. Your pastor talked about it. You're an overcomer. You keep plowing through it. Here is the secret. Bible school students used to ask me this. They said, Miss Debbie, can you tell us if you had to define one thing, how are you able to keep going? No matter if you've been smacked with something physically, and we always stand and walk that out till we have an awesome healing, because it belongs to all of us every time. It's part of the atonement. But when you're in the middle of the attack, how do you keep going? Or what about this? What about that? Would you say it's your strength? Would you say it's your tenacity? Would you say it's your bulldog determination? Whatever it is. I'll never forget the night they asked me. I was teaching in Bible school. And I said, oh, I'm so glad you asked. It's so simple. And they're waiting, oh, we're going to find out what's the best quality a minister needs. You know, you can see the pins come out. And I said, I know this is an old-fashioned song that a lot of you may not know, but it's so simple. He touched me. Uh-huh. Yes. Yeah. Oh, he touched me. It is so simple. When you've been under that touch, not just once, but when you've been under that spout where the Holy Ghost comes out. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something marvelous happened, and now I know he touched me and he made me whole. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. You can't even say that or sing that without him touching you again and again and again and again. I'm starting a Bible school, but I don't care if you're a 4-point. I don't care if you go on and get your doctorate. I don't care if you know all of the Hebrew and all of the Greek. Without that Holy Ghost touch, forget it. You are a babbling, tinkling junk. You are nothing without His touch. I'd rather have a kindergartner pray for me full of the Holy Ghost than somebody with 29 degrees that are full of themselves and dead religion and a big head but a skinny heart, a skinny spirit. We're not supposed to have big heads walking around with some bubble head and skinny spirits. We're supposed to have spirits this big. And yes! Hallelujah! 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 Oh, Rabash. Hallelujah! I'll carry this just in case we do something. Your reaction right now is because you're in a Holy Ghost church and you're sensitive to Him. If you let this moment pass you by and wait for the end, you may have missed the whole thing. He's moving now. He's touching now. He's imparting now. He's flooding you now. He's laying heavily upon you now. He's branding you now. Jesus. 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 Jesus! Hallelujah! 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 Rosoro Bulgorizi Vene Shembre Zebreske. Jesus! 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 Mosora Basobra Vene Sebre Brose. Jesus! Jesus. Tell you, most crowds, you can go through the audience, Jesus. And put your hand on a few people that the Holy Ghost is You can see them all over in this place tonight. It's everybody. It's everybody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. Every prophetic anointing, every call of God, sharpened, increased. Hungry, thirsty, desperate people. Jesus! 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 Whoa. Jesus!
Jesus!
Jesus! Holy Basil Brasso. Jesus! 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 Oh, Lord. There is nothing like your touch, nothing like the branding touch of the Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire. Jesus. The Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire, such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, prosavable. Jesus. 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 Sole cengli vilmo sante krabandili besa brashe. Jesus. Jesus. Sora bashabra. Kerama sombreske. Oh, le masambre shegle bebe kele be pon dele mesa bla be karabasso de be semete kele bise bre vo karaba pon dele masambre kele beske. You don't have anything that you're lacking, any problem, any circumstance, any physical problem, any lack, any money problem, any provision, nothing that more of the Holy Ghost won't fix. Or I should say responding to Him more. And letting the one who is everything and has everything just increase you and expand you and touch you and heal you and fill you and provide for you and talk to you and give you wisdom and give you knowledge and give you peace and give you joy. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. You got to get so hungry for God that He will do things for you He won't do for anybody else. He is no respecter of persons, but He is a respecter of principles. He doesn't look down a line and say, I've got blue-eyed favorites. He looks out and says, I got somebody who can't live without me. I've got somebody who will pay any price, who will go to the limit and say, Lord, only your will be done in my life. He looks down the line and sees hunger and sees thirst. And that's right where He stops and puts His mark, even though it was available to all.
So true.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You get to the place, this isn't just a revivalist slogan. I get so afraid that some of these things will become so commonplace to people that they can become common. You know, we ought to expect His miraculous and the Holy Ghost moving all the time, but we should never get where we go, old hat.
No way.
I loved it every night. every face. Remember it indelibly. I never get tired, Lord, of praying the sinner's prayer with somebody. I never get tired of seeing somebody come out of darkness and into light. I never get tired of seeing the look on the face when you're touching them, when you're revealing yourself to them. I never get tired of hearing that people just realize their calling. I never get tired of the joy unspeakable and full of glory. I never go, oh, you know, that's a lot of years for that now. We still doing that? I never get tired of people screaming out or weeping the sounds of revival. We sing about tonight the sounds of heaven. I never get tired of praising and worshiping you. I never get tired of being in your presence. Never get tired of preaching. Never get tired of anything that you're doing. And every time I stand amazed at you, I don't go, sometimes when you go, oh, he showed up again. Some people will go, well, of course he did. Don't you expect him to? No, I'm not saying it like that. Yeah, right. I expected him to. I'm saying it like, oh God, you're so amazing.
Yeah.
And each time I want to act like it's the only time that you were so good. You were so good and so awesome and so real and so precious and so holy. I never, never, never want that to be common. How could something so holy, so high, so deep, so wide, so magnificent, so from another realm, so from heaven, how could it ever be? Oh, that. Amen. Amen. So we stir ourselves up. We stir it up to say, I'm as hungry or hungrier as the first time I was ever touched. I'm as hungry or hungrier as when I first came to you. I'm as hungry as my first revival meeting when I was carried out of the building. I'm as hungry. Oh God, let me pursue you with everything within me. Hunger. It has to become a driving force. That's what drives me through any attack. He touched me. I want some more of that. I want to live in that. I want to walk in that. I want to talk in that. I want to look at his face some more. I want some more of those. He touched me. Hunger. The greatest hunger and thirst, the greatest driving forces on the face of the earth. A person starving in a desert will crawl to that spider. I haven't eaten in 2 months. It's a little spider, and hopefully it's not poison, but it at least will be some protein. It'll be something I haven't eaten. And then if they see a drop of mucky water, I've been in the desert. I've been days without water. This looks horrible, but I'm going to crawl. I'm going to dig my elbows in the sand because they're truly hungry. They're truly thirsty. And it's so interesting that he uses those two nouns or those two adverbs, I guess, if you are hungry, if you are thirsty. He uses those to compare spiritual hunger and thirst to natural hunger and thirst. And he says, you've got to get like that. And when you get like that, I got to have you, God. I know the meeting's a long way away and I get off work late and we might have to even skip dinner and we might, but oh God, I'm hungrier for you. I know they get out kind of late and we might not get so much sleep this week, but oh God, I'm hungrier and thirstier for you. That's what drives you in Alaska over icy roads an hour and a half away in a valley laden with moose. I already had a totaled car. I always said I didn't know how many more totalings it could take. And one of those stupid big moose, I'm telling you, this is what they do. They stand at the side of the road and they go, they're just standing there chewing their cud. Then they see a car coming, and they go, car coming on the ice. Think I'll mosey out there. And I've talked to people that they came through their windows, they completely demolished their car, they lost loved ones. And that was right, when the moose were out everywhere in between where I was and had to go. I had the three kids, didn't have much money for gas. But oh, he had already touched me. And I heard he was touching in those meetings. And instead of saying, when my friend called and said, Debbie, you got to get into those meetings in Anchorage. And I said, oh, Gene, I would love to, but, you know, I've got a missions trip tomorrow. I mean, I have the ministry. Do you know most ministers won't get more anointed because they're too busy?
Right.
I said, I got a missions trip plan. That sounds like a pretty good thing. I'm going to a village. I'm going to hold my own revival. I got a prison ministry. I'm pastoring a church. And I said, the first time he came, by the second time he came, I resigned that when I went to that pastor. But anyway, I said, I can't go. I would love to go. But she said, Debbie, what glory is in those meetings? And the word glory contained the glory of God in that moment. And it came through my telephone wire and smacked me in the face. You can believe that or not believe that. I went to the floor. And the glory, one of the definitions of it is the heavy, the heavier still, the laying heavily upon you, the glory of Almighty God, His impotence, omnipotence, I mean, and His weight, and His, in that Shekinah is His light and His splendor and His numbers and His integrity and His character and all of it that came through those telephone wires and laid heavily upon me on the floor. I'm laughing and crying and in tongues. And when I got up, I thought, I wonder if she's still on the phone. And when I got up, she was laughing and crying too. And I said, I'll go. I'll drop everything. I'll cancel my revival meeting. I got to have more. Because He had touched me. And I wanted more. But some preachers will go, we're already having some of that joy. We're already having this and this and that. Not when you're still hungry. Not when you're still hungry and thirsty. You got to get that kind of hungry, famished hungry, desperate hungry. Not typical American hunger, naturally and spiritually, that is like this. You go to somebody's house and they say, are you hungry? You want something to eat? And you're thinking, I haven't eaten in an hour. Yeah, I guess I could shove something down. And they get out the pie and you're like, I ate an hour ago, but I can still get that. That's how we let ourselves get spiritually too. I guess I can go to the meeting, you know. I mean, I got pretty touched last night, but I guess I can throw another night in. But when you go, last night was last night, and we ain't seen nothing yet. I'm going tonight to get something I didn't get last night, to get something I didn't get last month, to get something I didn't get 3 months ago, or to get more of what I've already gotten. I'm going to meet with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm going to meet with the One who lays heavily upon me. And you couldn't get me to stay home if you tried. That kind of hunger. That kind of thirst. So here was the slogan I was going to say a while ago that can become nonchalant. Revival. Give me revival or give me death. Revival. Nothing less, nothing more, nothing else. And that may mean different terms to different people, but I'm talking about being more sensitive to Him. I'm talking about being the most on fire I've ever been. I'm talking about falling in love with Him more than I've ever been in love with Him. I'm talking about walking and talking with Him. I'm talking about being so fired up I'm not aware of anybody else in the auditorium. I'm talking about that kind of stuff in revival. And where you go, I gotta live like that or let me die because I'm not doing anything in between. Jesus, Jesus. It's easy for people to lose the hunger they once had. I see it on people. You can see it on their face. They're sitting in the same seat. They're taking the same notes. They're amening in the same place, but it's not there. And everybody knows it but them. Hallelujah. Amen. Good word, Sister Debbie. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I remember I used to, in the beginning days of revival, it would take me a night or two just to preach people hungry so they could start receiving. But, you know, you'd say, who wants more of God? You'd get some of this. And you'd see some people scratching their heads. They were still trying to figure that out. More of Him. Let's see. I'm saved. My sins are forgiven. And I'm going to heaven. Not dying of anything terminal. Haven't committed adultery. Do I need more? I don't think so. She must be talking to somebody, but not me. And you're going, look, this isn't a physics class. I said, who? Because I thought maybe they thought that's where we were or something. I said, if you don't want more, I've got another question for you. Would you like to get saved? Because we have that line too. And they just look at me like, no, I don't need that, but I don't need that. And I'm like, no, it's one or the other. It's one or the other. If you're not hungry enough to even know that you need something, maybe we need to start all over at the born again state. Maybe that never really happened to you, because when your spirit is recreated and when you're in love with Him, you want to be in His presence, you want to be in His church, you want all of it. You want to be in His word, you want to pray, you want to worship, you want to praise. Hallelujah. You've got to have that hunger as a driving force. You got to get desperate to be a nation shaker. No, that's where we part ways, Miss Debbie. Sorry, but I'm just called to sit in the pew, say amen. I come and I put my money in the offering plate. We all have different callings. It's true that we have some different offices, but there is no such thing as a calling to come sit in the pew, put the money in the plate, and just say amen. That's all I ever do with my life. There is no such thing. Some people are going, oh, now I'm not even called to that. I don't know what I'm called to do. No. We are called, every one of us in here are called to shape nations. Yes. Every one of us in here are called. I'm not saying everybody's going to go, but you're called to shape nations by the way you pray, by the way you give, by the way that you participate in everything going on in the house, by how many souls you're reaching out here that may run to the nations, by getting up every day and winning the lost, by stepping over and interceding even sometimes for people in other nations when you don't even know consciously that's what you're doing, and by having a burden for the lost, by every soul that you see realizing they're going to spend all of eternity in one place or the other, and you may be the last person they see. We are called to shake nations. We are called to be revivalists. We are called to be the blood-bought church. We are called to represent Jesus and be His ambassador on this earth. We are called to take the land like Joshua and Caleb. We are certainly not called to be one of the 10 spies. Amen. If that's who you're identifying with, that's not good. I don't, Pastor Mark, he's such a dreamer. I know he thinks we can do this and this and this. And then now he wants to try this and do this. And I wish somebody would tell him he can't do all those things. Wish somebody would tell him, just be happy right here in this. You know, we got a nice thing going. We got a nice church. We got a great worship. Ain't going to happen. Ain't going to happen. And guess what? I know many of my church is watching and they already know this too, but it isn't going to happen with me either. It isn't going to happen with me either. I got used to a long time ago people in my face saying, you're a woman. You're a woman. Alaska's cold. You don't have a husband. At least I can't say that anymore. I got used to people telling me 100, even my dad, even my father called when I was an Alaska missionary and he goes, I just got to talk to you about something. You got 3 boys. Have you forgotten that you have 3 sons? This stupid missionary, again, these revelatory remarks. I mean, I'm like, oh, I hope I didn't leave them somewhere. I forgot I had kids. No, he said, this dumb missionary idea. I'm afraid you're going to starve to death, or your kids are, and we're too poor, we can't help you. I said, Dad, I never asked you to. I appreciate the thought, but I never asked you to. God's going to take care of me. Tell me how He's going to do it. Now, fast forward a few years, as we went into 40 nations many times and had such favor and such incredible things. As I'm telling them, I preached at Madison Square Garden the other day, preached from Royal Albert Hall in London where the Queen has her box the other day, been on television now, didn't ask to go on television, they just put me on nation all over the nation, but and I could tell my parents, they just kind of changed the subject, but now they're kind of starting to look like, really? Now listen to this. When my father was sick, I would try to leave healing books and talk to him about it, but they wouldn't hear anything about it. But at least I got to lead him to the Lord before he went on, and led him to the Lord in a powerful way, and was there when he passed on, was there when he came out of the coma and pointed at the ceiling and just went, just like that, and never breathed out. But guess what led him to the Lord? Remember I was talking about last night? They need to see the goodness of God in every area. Guess what led him to the Lord? He came to my house in Tampa. And you know, I've been living in with other people in Alaska, and we had an old trailer, and the fuel oil cost more than the trailer cost, and I had to move out of that and move in with people in my church. But now I'm in Tampa, Florida. I have a beautiful new home for the first time in my life. I have a brand spanking new car that somebody bought for me. And my dad walked in the bedroom, my bedroom, and I saw him going. I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm counting off the feet of your bedroom. Your bedroom's bigger than my house." And it wasn't, he was exaggerating, but my mother still lives in that 900 and some square foot house that my dad built when I was going in kindergarten. And he looked out and he saw the swimming pool, just a small pool, but to them in Nebraska, I mean, only movie stars in Hollywood have swimming pools. And so then shortly after that, I saw him just kind of thinking. And then shortly after that, I went back to visit them in Nebraska, and my mom and dad weren't at the airport, and I knew he was struggling. He was fighting cancer, and they said he didn't have much longer to live. And I said, "Where's my mom and dad?" My aunt and uncle were there, and they said, "Well, not only is your dad hurting, but they couldn't drive their car. My dad was always a good mechanic, always bought older cars and always kept them up impeccable. And they said, you know, he's too sick to work in the car anymore, and the windows won't even roll down, and the air conditioning quit working, and this is wrong and that's wrong, so they couldn't come to Omaha to come after you, so they sent us." And I said, "Okay," and I got there. It was just a day before my father's birthday. I said, "Dad, what do you say we get in the car and go looking at that town you always get your cars at? What's the use? Don't have my health, don't have any money, don't have any, and I hate leaving your mom like this with this broken down car." And I said, "Let's just go look. You feel good enough just to look?" I guess. He sees this Buick out there. He always got Chevys, but he had kind of started getting Buicks. And he looks at this new Buick and he said, "Whew." And I went, Went in, signed the papers, came out and said, "Dad, here's your first brand new car." And he started weeping on the spot, and he couldn't stop. I've never seen my dad cry. He's weeping, and he said, "You, of my three kids, the one that didn't have the husband." I thought, "Oh yeah, you do remember that." He said, the one that had this crazy missionary idea. When my other two kids got mates, and you know, they're both working and stable things, and he said, "I always said all my life I'd never have a new car because I'm just a poor man. You know, my maiden name is Rich. His name is Rich, and he was a country singer. So he wrote a song, 'Don't This Poor Rich Man Deserve to,' anyway." And the typical country song. And he said, "I always said I'd never have a new car, that you got to be born with a silver spoon in your mouth to have a new car." And rah, 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 rah. And he said, "And you did this?" And I just turned it real quick and said, "There's only one way I was able to do that. Remember when I told you my God will meet all of my needs? I said, my kids are blessed. They're in college. God is blessing me, Dad. God has healed my body. God wants to heal your body. God, and he's just weeping. And I led him to the Lord when he would never have anything to do with even hearing about it, on the spot, because of the goodness of God. Even the people criticizing you for what you believe, for healing, for that God wants to bless you, make you a blessing, they're criticizing you. They're half mad, but they're half waiting to see if it can really happen. They're half waiting to see, can they really have anything that they say they can have? And they're waiting to see you get so hungry and so thirsty and so desirous of his touch that you won't settle for anything less than everything that he says we have in him. And when they see you going after that, they're making fun of you on the way. They're laughing about I'm telling you, people, that man who told me I was a woman and that Alaska was cold and that I had no husband, I still remember the day in Alaska. I mean, I'm living in with other people. I have barely anything, but I'm getting a hold of giving my way out of nothing and out of poverty. And I decided I'm sending a check to everybody that prophesied anything negative, spoke anything negative about me. And I sent $100 checks out all over the place. And for me at that time, that was like sending out a $10,000 one to everybody today. And as I sent those out, I didn't send it out even sarcastic. I sent it out, man of God, I understand why you were trying to tell me this. You were trying to save me and my sons from a lot of heartache, and I appreciate that. But I just want you to know I sought the Lord, and I'm going on with Him. But I bless you. And he wrote back, and I'll say he wrote back and said, a lesser woman of God would have taken my opinion very seriously. But you aren't a lesser woman of God, and I can't wait to see you blessed. And I tell you, but I learned early on that even the people that write books about you and against you, you know, there was a day where people were telling me that I was now on the web with Pastor Rodney being criticized alongside him. And I got so excited. I thought, wow, nobody even used to know who I was on the web. I mean, the anointing is increasing. So I looked it up. I just got curious. And here's what it said. I was laughing so hard. It says, if that man isn't bad enough with all of his false doctrine, then if he's not bad enough, he brings out a woman before him that will pull the gold right out of your teeth. And I started laughing so hard. I thought, well, awesome. There are ministries that have giftings to go around putting it in teeth, and I'll just come around behind, take it out, and they can. And no, I'm kidding, of course. But I thought, what you people don't know.
Right.
There's a song that says it. You weren't there the night he touched me.
Right.
You weren't there the night he wrapped his loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. And you laugh at the gift and you mock the gift. But I might be underwriting you one of these days, because in this hour that we live in, we're going to need everybody together and every partner reaping the harvest. And we're going to have to say, look, you want to go there? You want to preach? I'm going to pay the tab. And they're going to go, after I mocked you and wrote books about you? Yes, after that. Because I know you just didn't understand. But I want you to know there's where we were. I tell people, you've come too late to tell me he won't provide for me. I've been there and I've been here, and here is better. You've come too late to say he's not the healer. I was there in the hospital when they said she can't make it. She can't even make it to the hospital. Then in the hospital, they said, we're going to be honest with you, lady. We don't know how you've survived the last hour to get to the hospital, but you have no chance of survival this night. They said, you have the largest, mark that down. I want to get into these records someday and find out some stuff. But they said, you have the largest saddle pulmonary embolism we have ever seen in the history of Tampa General Hospital. And they said it could be in the world if we had time to compare records. They said when we have somebody on the operating table that throws one of those in the place, what they mean by a saddle embolism was it set in between both lungs. They said it had fingers that went into every lobe of both lungs and cut off all oxygen to every part of the body at the moment it hit. They said, we have never seen anybody who gets one half that size, even while they're on the operating table. We've never been able to resuscitate them. They aren't the only ones that have said that. At a hospital that we use in Washington State, a military teaching hospital, they've seen my records, and I always know when they come to it. Even if I go to just get a immunization to go in the foreign field or something, they'll just be reading. I always can see when it happens. Ma'am, has anybody ever told you you can't be alive? Oh, yeah. Yeah, many people said that. Let me tell you a story about my healing Jesus. Hallelujah. So, when you get hungry and thirsty like that, there's no giving up anything. Are you kidding me? What he's done for me. Are you kidding me? Sacrifices I'm making. Oh, it must be so hard traveling the world. It must be so hard. Are you kidding me? Yeah, there's some stuff that we lay down. Yeah, there's some stuff that wears on your body. Yeah, I'm not denying all that. But it's not, I don't know, he's kind of touched me. Should I do this? Should I not? It's, he touched me. How much has he touched you, folks? Oh, there's so much he's put in my heart just on the subject of hunger, and we aren't going to get to it, obviously. I want to experience his power stronger, so I'm desperate. Haggai 2:9, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. I want to be one of those in this last moment where the knowledge of the glory of the Lord is increasing. I want to be one of those who has knowledge of his glory. That's not just that he has glory. I got knowledge that he has glory. I want to have knowledge to know how to prophesy in the glory, how to wait in the glory, how to dance in the glory, how to sing in the glory, how to cry in the glory, how to shout in the glory, how to lay in the glory, how to run in the glory, how to operate in the gifts of the Spirit in the glory. I want to have the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. And to do that, I got to stay hungry, and so do you. You have tasted more here than probably 95% of the world has. But oh, we haven't even gotten started. I feel when you talk about it, you can feel the Holy Ghost going, amen. If I was sitting in your seat, I'd be saying, amen, Debbie. Yeah. You haven't even touched what there is in me yet. He's just waiting for the hunger level to come up, for the thirst level to come up, for the desperation to come up, for the getting out of his way. He's just waiting for us to go, God, more than anything, I want you. I want you. So how? I feel like Richard. How are we going to walk in? There are things we haven't touched yet that we may or may not tomorrow night. I don't know at this point. But how are we going to walk in our authority? How are we going to walk in holiness? How are we going to walk in his goodness and his joy and letting everybody know who he is? How are we going to walk in signs and wonders? How are we going to walk in faith? How are we going to walk in divine love and forgiveness? How are we going to walk in those things that are like, I'm trying, Lord, I'm trying. No. We aren't going to do it out of here. We aren't even going to do it out of our discipline, even though there were some things he will ask us to do and lay down. We aren't going to do it out of our wants to. We're going to do it out of, I'm so hungry for you. And I'm going to let you do anything. I'm going to let you touch me and brand me and sit on me and lay on me. I'm going to let you do spiritual surgery on me. I'm going to let you put your mark on me in such a way that I just come out of here and people say, what has happened to you? Who are you? I'm going to close with this. And I went years without sharing this with anybody except the two or three people that were around the day it happened. That I finally one day told Pastor Rodney, right after he came to visit me after that blood clot. And then I finally said it to my church a while back. But all my years in the revival trail, I never told it for many reasons. Many reasons, one being that it was too holy and too precious. One being that so many people say things that never took place and you don't even want to cheapen anything by getting in that category. But in 1984, still back in Nebraska, I was going through so much in a marriage where I was being abused, even physically, cheated on, every day a barrage of verbal abuse, and had three boys, and I felt marriage was forever, and it is forever, and I didn't know how I could keep going. And this particular Sunday, we went to church, and I said on the way to church, I'm ashamed to say it, this isn't in my notes either, people, so somebody or somebody's, listen carefully. On the way to church, I said, I don't even know why we go to church. We go there, I get touched by the power of God, I get hope in me, and then I go back into home and live in a living hell. I just had so had it that day, I didn't care if I got smacked when I finally said that or what. I said, I don't even feel like going in the door because I just get a touch and I gotta go back into that. And of course, that did make him very angry. Shut up, we're going in. We got in and our church was having an evangelist that week. Never heard of him before or since. And he, the last thing I said was, I feel like I'm living in some kind of desert experience. I'm never gonna come out the other side. And the man preaches on the desert experience. And then he at the end, operating in perfect word of knowledge, he says, somebody is here that just said this today, and you feel there is no hope, and I preach this message just for you. Come up here. Amen. Did I go running up there like any halfway smart person? Oh, no. I set my seat with my pride.
Oh, yeah.
I set my seat going, okay, I teach a Sunday school class. The people in the church know I got to call a God in my life. If I go up, they're going to know I've been this hopeless. I've been this depressed. I've been thinking about, do I even want to live? How embarrassing. I'm supposed to be above this. So I sat there and I thought, surely somebody will answer it. Well, first of all, it was a small church to begin with. And he got pretty specific. He's like, please, I know you're here. I know you're here. And nobody goes. Nobody goes up. And you see the poor evangelist stand there like, maybe I'm not anointed. Maybe I don't hear from, I mean, I could see that on his face. And I felt sorry for him. I felt sorry for him. So when we're getting ready to leave, it was November. I'm telling you, so many things have happened in my life in November. That's so interesting. And as I went to say that, I just realized that's where we're at again. It was November that Pastor Rodney came to Alaska, and this was November in 1984. But I'm putting my coat on, and I thought, that poor guy, he's standing up there feeling like he missed God entirely. I should go back. All the people have left, pretty much. Nobody's going to see me up there. I think I got to run up there and at least tell him, sorry, mister, it was my fault. It was me, so I did. I at least did that, gutless as I was. I at least did that. I ran back up, and I said, sir, it was me. I'm so sorry. And I just sat there in pride, and he said, I want to pray for you right now. And he said, I'm going to break the spirit of oppression and suicide off of you. And then he said this. He said, but I'm going to tell you something, sister. I know you're going back home to the same mess. So even though I've broken that spirit off, he said, you're going to have to face those circumstances tomorrow. And when you do, I want you to start praising and worshiping like you've never praised and worshiped. Yeah. I want you to get into the word like you've never gotten the word. I want you to pray like you've never prayed. Thank you, sir. Yes, God bless you. Thank you. I leave. I got up the next morning, and of course, the person abusing me, of course, those tormenting devils were worse than ever.
Sure.
And sure. He just got up in this rage, and he goes to work. And I sat there, and I thought, so what was that for last night? Nothing. I'm telling you, people, this is so far from my message. Somebody has a chance tonight. Right. Somebody has an invitation tonight, right, to come out of this once and for all.
Right.
And I'm obeying the Holy Ghost. So that next day, I'm falling into that depression all over again and that oppression. And I'm just going, man, if he doesn't change, I don't care how many of us have prayed for him and fasted, he gets worse. And how can I continue to live like this? Wow, this is a big one for me to say. Never been in a revival crowd and said it. He also was the town cop, small town. So even though he was abusing me, who can I call? Other women could call him, but I had nobody to call. He had a 45 gun laying there, pistol. And after he was gone to work, I had never done that before. I took the pistol down off the shelf. And as I took it down off the shelf, I knew it was loaded. And I knew gun safety because we would go out with the boys and shoot cans and stuff. I knew gun safety, but I was in a state where I wasn't thinking. And I took it and I was holding it. And I knew I never intended to do anything. But you know how when you're in a pity party and you fall in that bad, you're going to really make God upset that he hasn't come through for you. That's the most foolish thing in the world, but people can get like that. So I'm holding this gun and I'm going, God, maybe I should just end it. There is no hope here. There is no help here. There is no anything. And then all of a sudden, by the grace of God, it's like I came to myself and thought, Debbie, what are you doing? You are holding a loaded pistol. I mean, how bad is this thing? And so I went to release, it was right here, and I went to release it out of my hand because I was crying and I was shaking and I was telling God how he should have done more for me than he's done and how I have waited and I didn't sleep with people like the rest of the youth group and I waited for marriage and I waited for a Christian guy and now look, they marry drunks and rock singers and they get saved and they're in the ministry and I, you know, this shouldn't have happened to me and I'm crying and my shoulders are shaking and when I went to throw a loaded gun, I went to let it go down in the bed, and right here, it went off. It went off. I had powder burns all over my face. And that so scared me, that thunderous sound. And we found the bullet later in the basement. It had gone through the bed. It had gone through the bedroom floor. It had gone down into the basement. And I just sat there shaking. And I thought, dear God, how far have you fallen? You who've known the Lord since you were a little girl and been baptized in the Holy Ghost and Spirit, how far have you fallen to get that low? What is wrong with you, girl? And then all of a sudden, the evangelist words came pouring back to me. And I said, oh God, I'm so sorry. Oh God, forgive me and wash me in your blood. And I began to praise him and worship him and dance before him. And when I was through doing that, I sat down for about an hour in the Word and just was just eating it. And then after that, I thought, and now I'm going to kneel down. I wouldn't have had to kneel down, but I just felt I wanted to reverentially kneel down and pray. And as I knelt down, I only started praying. To this day, I have no idea because I couldn't tell natural time from what was happening to me. I have no idea. I think it was just a few seconds. But I just started to pray. And I left my body. And I saw like in the distance, like the heavenly city, but it was like in the distance. And I know this sounds so strange. I've never heard anybody's like it. But I saw this white, like a white wrought iron bench. And I'm just in this, whether I was there, whether I was just in the spiritual realm, I don't know to this day. But I start walking towards that bench and I see Jesus walking towards me. And as I did, I had never heard anybody say that back then. I have since then. But as I did, there were so many things I thought if I ever could ask the Lord, I have a list. Have anybody ever been there? I got a list. I can't wait to ask this and this and that. When I saw him, I was not even aware of any list.
Right.
Any questions? No questions. But I saw liquid eyes of love. Of love and grace and mercy that permeated my being. And what I was going to ask was nothing on that list, but what came to me to ask before I could ask it, it went whoof, whoof. The answer flooded me before I could ask the question. And I stood there and I knew, his mouth didn't move, his lips didn't move, but I knew I knew that I was so loved. And that if God could be for me, who could be against me? And I didn't ask him anything about him, our marriage. I was in a realm, I wasn't even aware of it. And I have no idea how long that was. All I know is that I actually saw myself slide right back into my body again, kneeling at the foot of the bed. And I was so overcome. There was nothing more to pray about. There was nothing more to talk about. There was nothing more. And I was just sitting. I went out to the kitchen table. And I was just sitting there when he came home from work. And I was thinking, I can't tell him. It's too precious. It's too real. He'll just mock it. He'll just make fun of it. I'm not saying a word. This is how the Holy Ghost took me here tonight. Because when he walked in, the man who had never said anything like that, I don't care what kind of move of the Holy Ghost there is, I don't care what kind of preaching, I don't care. He never says anything like this. He walked in and said, "My God, what has happened to you?" And I finally could speak, and I said, "Why?" He said, "Because I've never seen your face like that. I can feel whatever it is standing over here." And I thought, do I say anything? Do I not? I finally told him, and he just sat there and he said, "Did he say anything about me?" I said, "No." And I didn't ask anything. We went to church that night, and he said, "I think you should tell the pastor." I was kind of reluctant, but I finally did, who told the evangelist, who asked me to come up and tell it in the pulpit. That was the only time I ever did until I did to Pastor Rodney and then to our church. But when I did, we had some unsaved people there that night. They came running to the altar and got saved. But I held it so dear to me all these years. That's still, however you want to call it, that was still just one more manifestation of the Holy Ghost. How can I get up? How can I keep going?
Right.
He touched me. And he doesn't love me more than he loves you.
Right.
He doesn't love me more than he loves one person in here. He is so real. Yes. So real. I laid there in that table in Tampa when they said, "You're going to die." And I was gurgling. I would rip the oxygen mask off my face for just seconds at a time. I could never get a whole sentence out because they said, "We're hitting you with clot busters, but it won't have enough time to dissolve that huge one. You're just not." And they said, "Your heart's so enlarged from trying to beat 200 and some beats a minute to try to get it," because the heart didn't know. How come we can't get any oxygen anywhere to any part of the body? And lady, it's just too bad, but we're going to be honest with you. And I pulled that off, and I gurgled out, "I shall live and not die." And they said, "Well, we know that's what you want, and we're trying to work it." No, and I pull it off again. "I am called by him. He loves me." And they're just like, "Well, good thing you believe that. You're going to need him." But when my doctor came in at the end of 8 days, he said, "You know what I'm carrying in my pocket? A picture of the blood clot." He said, "I'm going to a medical convention. I've been asked to speak on something else, but I'm dropping everything I was speaking on and going to show them this because nobody's going to believe you survived it." And I said, "Hey, doc, by the way, when can I start exercising?" And he started laughing. He said, "No, you're not understanding. You've had, and I'll even call it a miracle, okay? You've had that. But you will never exercise again. You won't even have the energy for it. You'll never fly again. You'll never preach again." You're like, "Oh, really?" 2 weeks later, I went to a pulmonologist. And I'm still on crutches because I had had a little minor foot surgery that led to all of that. And I should have just believed God. Should have believed God, but you know how you do. Oh, I'm fighting these big battles over here. This is just a little easy ankle surgery. I already had the other one done 3 years ago. No problems. And you know, but I had this check. And I'm, well, that one was fine. Why won't this one be fine? Well, it wasn't. But I'm still in a boot from that ankle surgery, and I'm on crutches. Anybody know, anybody ever been on crutches? You know how much oxygen that takes, let alone when you're hooked up to oxygen? And so I went in there and I said, "I want to come off the oxygen." The pulmonologist laughed. "Lady, you're going to be on oxygen at least 5 years, probably all your life." And no, I'm healed. Lady, I tell you what I'm going to do for you because you're so insistent. We're going to unhook you from all this. And I want you to try on those crutches to go around my office once. He sent a nurse with me. I'm going around on crutches all over that. I go around it three times and four times. And he comes and he hells us down. Stop. She said, Doc. She said she's at 100% oxygen. Even healthy people aren't usually at 100% oxygen. It's usually more like 99% or something. And he said, well, I guess somebody on 100% oxygen doesn't need to be on oxygen, do you? It was the same when I asked him to come off blood thinners. It just, good God. But listen, folks. You can give in to, listen to this, even after I was saved, look at what's happening. Or you can go, no, you're good all the time. Yes. You're good all the time. And this shall be temporary. And you've touched me. And you will touch me again and again and again and again and again. And I will live to proclaim your goodness and your power and your greatness all over the face of the earth. So let me circle back and sum it up with this. This church has known great revival. You've known great touches of God through the years. And some were here when I was here. You were touching those meetings. You've been touching Richard's meetings. You've been touching Tim Hall's meetings. You've been touched in Brother Hoon's meetings. You've been touching so many's meetings. Pastor Rodney's meetings. You've been touched from people who are operating in some of the most powerful anointings on the face of the earth. What a divine privilege. Better not squander that. Better not let that become common. Better not let that be, oh, another nice touch. I've seen him move greater, higher, more. No. I will say what I said last night again. Even Pastor Mark was saying it in a different way tonight. All these giftings here, all of these that we can, and I love it because I can feel it as I preach. You just feel like, I could go here. We could step over into this. We could. You can feel that. I mean, this building contains, it's just a building, but it contains molecules that have been touched by the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the glory of God. And in the book of Acts, if the building was shaken in which they were assembled as they began to pray, that's why it doesn't surprise me when people shake. Some people say, Debbie, do you think that was real when that person was shaken? I say, are you kidding me? It doesn't surprise me that somebody shakes when the one who says, let there be light, and there was light, begins to sit on them. It doesn't surprise me somebody begins to shake. All that surprises me is that our whole heads don't blow off. But when you have known that so many times, you can start to go, que sera, sera. I'm here to tell you, there is a divine purpose. There is a divine purpose for everybody. Yes, I realize that. But I'm telling you, there are places in the spiritual realm God is calling this body to and calling your particular giftings to and your unique giftings to that most people haven't even heard about yet. And as you've been back here, don't decarama elegimblo fomo so remasete caramafo boso remishingly vi praticarama futuruso basho fomo so negerem esembreske. As you have been participating in learning and yielding and coming and in stirring yourselves up to hunger and thirst, and more has come and more has been given, and then you were stretched, and then you were stretched, and then you had to come out of your comfort zone, and then you had to be filled again, and then you went to another place, and then you were stretched again, and then you had to go to another place, and you were stretched again, and you went to another place, and some even ask, oh God, isn't it enough now? Can I just sit back for a while? Can I just relax for a while? Oh no, 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 no. You have been branded. You have been marked. You have been called. You have been anointed. You have been shown revelation. You have had a realm of the word opened up unto you. And you are responsible to go and win the lost and show forth and demonstrate and do great exploits and pray like you've never prayed and enter new dimensions and enter new places in the Holy Ghost and come up higher 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 until one of these days you'll take one more step all the way up, all the way up, all the way up. Hallelujah. 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 I could wait, but I can't when I see hunger. Jesus! I've been back here once tonight. But Lord, more. 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 More is stretching to hold more. And more. And more. And more. And more. And more. We've got a pocket right here. Jesus. 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 We're going somewhere together, folks. We're going somewhere together. God will call all of these people with these same stirrings, with these same, can't get enough, with these same, I'm on a quest, like Richard said, with the same, I want to walk holy before Him. And I only want, He's going to bring us together like He's doing divinely already in Washington and Oregon and California. And He'll bring us together with others, and He'll bring us together with people all over the earth. It'll bring us together because the church shall be the church, the glorious church. The glorious church, the glorious church, the glorious church, the glorious church. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus. I'm going to ask this before we go further with the hunger and thirst. This last story obviously was intensely personal, something I've never shared in revival. But I'm going to ask, like the evangelist asked that Sunday, but I wouldn't come up. Man, I could have forfeited everything. I wonder where I don't even want to think about. I don't even want to think about if I didn't turn around and humble myself and repent. I don't even want to think about it, but one thing's for sure, I wouldn't be here tonight if I wouldn't have got set free. I couldn't pray for you to be free tonight. So all over this auditorium, I'm going to ask who would say, I've had that hopelessness. It may not even be for the same reason. It may not be a bad, abusive marriage. It may be whatever. Maybe incest when you were a child. Maybe a rape. Maybe alcoholism. Maybe being unloved by your parents. Maybe something a teacher said to you when you were young, whatever it is, you say, no, that's got to be behind me, out of me, no more to ever be considered. And I need to feel that same compassion and love. You may not see the Lord, but oh, in the realms of the Spirit, you can look in His face tonight. You can look in His face tonight and receive everything that He has for you. And know He loves me. If God be for me, who can be against me? So I'm going to ask all over this building who would say, that's for me. I need this tonight. I need to be free tonight. I need totally free from whatever it is, any harassing devil, any, thank you. Hands going up everywhere. All right, I'm going to ask all of you to come up first. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 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 He who the Son sets free is free indeed. Is free indeed. Lord, as I get ready to lay my hands on people tonight, we thank You that You're the great deliverer. You are the compassionate one. You are the Savior. You are the healer. You are the one who floods them and fills them and baptizes them with the Holy Ghost and with fire. You are the ones who can go, the one who can go back in time and rip anything out that needs to be ripped out and pour in the healing balm of Gilead and fill up that hole. At the same time, You are the one who gives great hope and joy right in the middle of present circumstances. You are the one. You are the one that calls me and told me to go into that tonight. So I thank You, Lord. I thank You, Lord. I thank You, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Free. and knowing how loved he is by you in the name which is above every name. Free! And he who the Son sets free is free indeed. Go where no man can go. Go where the knife of man cannot go. Barimbo gore sapashabre. Never, ever, ever the same. In Jesus' mighty name. Plosambra. Jesus. Jesus! Lord, your love, your compassion, your healing power. Jesus, Jesus, put your hand heavily upon this young man, Lord, never the same. Jesus, Jesus, Kelemaso, Rabaso, Jimblese, never, ever, ever the same. Just one moment, just one touch, just one touch. And Lord, we're never, ever, ever the same. Brand him tonight in holy fire. Prosakaraba, dorise vebeshe, vengili misobra, vrosaba. Never, ever, ever, ever the same. Never the same. Poribiso. Never the same in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord, that you go where the hand of man cannot go, where my words can't go, where nobody's words can go. It's over. It's done. It's finished under the hand of the Lord. Prosakri ve pandit chomo sandi kerebe. Vikoris sovomo shamre. Eleba jambre sike. Jesus. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. New night, new beginning. Jesus, your love running down her. Your loving arms wrapping around her. Your river bubbling up from her. Your fire, your fire, your fire, Lord. Your fire. Cauterize every wound, every deep place, every hidden place. For she is totally free in Jesus' name. Never, ever, ever the same. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Lord, I love these young people coming forward. God, nation shakers, water walkers, operating in the Holy Ghost. Go where no hand can go. Go where no doctor, no psychiatrist can go. Go where no counselor can go. You are the great counselor. So great counselor, have at it. Lord, do spiritual surgery. Fill him. Flood him. Morebe. Echemako. Brisevemetekelebe. Never, ever, ever the same. In Jesus' mighty name. Never the same. Not going to carry it any longer. The pain, the regrets, any condemnation, the hurt, the bitterness, not going to carry it any longer. The fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' mighty name. Never the same. And Lord, for these young men, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you're raising up a generation that won't bend or bow or compromise. Full of the Holy Ghost. Full of the Word of God. Lord, go. Go where you need to go tonight, but mark him with your Holy Ghost in fire. Never, ever, ever the same in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, your sweet, precious anointing. Your sweet, precious anointing. Your sweet, precious anointing. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Maro bosanebe de grisama venkila mashabros of a botone. Never the same in Jesus' mighty name. Fill her up, Lord, fill her up, Lord, fill her up, Lord. Change from the inside out, unrecognizable in the glory of the living God. Mosambre ve meshambre vokarabe. Zefemeshebre, votalabasotike, jeprese, jeprese. Oh Lord, again, one touch, more yet, more yet. Brand him, like Gene was saying that night, brand him. where he looks different, walks different, talks different, and knows who he belongs to. Free. Free. So sold out, so yielded, so sensitive to you. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus. Lord, she's already under the spout where the glory comes out. More, more, more. Jesus, Jesus. Tonight, Lord, she's come to say, this is it, it's done, it's over. Freedom, 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 freedom. Freedom, freedom, freedom. We look into those eyes of liquid love, and yet eyes of fire at the same time, and holy eyes at the same time, and perfect eyes at the same time. And we say, have your perfect way. Lord, have your perfect way. Have your perfect way. Totally free. The past is the past at last. By the blood, by the name. Rechembre sokrofaba, tofamasembre. Yes, Lord, it's time. It's time for it to be over. It's time. It's time to be so completely surrendered and saying, Lord, I will not come back to that place anymore. I will not deal with this anymore. Lord, I thank you that you set me free, that your eyes, your heart of love and compassion and mercy and grace and freedom and boldness. Baro bose. In Jesus' mighty name, in Jesus' mighty name. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Again, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. We thank you for your glory. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your callings. We thank you, Lord, that right here, right now, she meets up with the one who touches her and fills her and changes her and sets her free, where she sings, he touched me. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You know he saves the best wine for last, right? Jesus, never the same, never the same. Never the same in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. 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 Is there anyone here who would say with an uplifted hand, I don't even know this Jesus? You're talking about hunger and thirst, Pastor Debbie, but I've never even met him. I've heard some religious things about him. I think I've said a couple prayers in my life, but I don't have a personal relationship with him. I've never repented. I've never asked him to forgive me of my sin and come in and cleanse me and wash me in his blood and give me brand new life. If that's you and you want to receive that brand new life tonight, would you lift your hand? All right. All right. I'm going to ask you, how many feel a stirring, the greater hunger, greater thirsting? Would you stand with me? Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord, you've told me to give out what I have and to cause people to get hungry for more. And Lord, that you are no respecter of persons. You said that in your word. And so, Lord, I thank you that tonight, again, afresh, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the fire of the living God, the anointing of the living God, the glory of the living God saturates them tonight. Saturates them tonight. Saturates them. Lord, we stir in the realms of the spirit. We just stir that hunger. We stir that thirst. We stir it. We stir it. We stir it till they can't get enough of you, where they're craving you every waking moment. And even in their sleep, they're dreaming of you and they're still talking to you. Lord, we thank you that they can't get enough of you. We thank you for impartations of the Holy Ghost. We thank you for callings coming to fruition. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus.
Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. Father, we thank you for the precious blood of Jesus. Father, we thank you for this mighty, mighty name. In the mighty name of Jesus, say, in the mighty name of Jesus. No, say it stronger. In the mighty name of Jesus. And this is how I live. I live and move in him. In the mighty name of Jesus, this is how I live, in joy and rejoicing, flowing in the Holy Ghost, not bound to circumstances, not under any limitations, but mounting up with wings. I'm flying in his glory, continually filled by his spirit. Dear people, I know that there are people in here tonight, you have hard circumstances that you're living in. And I'm just so blessed that Debbie was so transparent with you. You got to get the part of worshiping and rejoicing and praising him in the fiery furnace of affliction. I mean, just, Father's got a deliverance. You have to quit obeying and bowing your knee to your circumstance and your situation. Father, we pray right now for the spirit of wisdom and revelation to come to these different folks that have to go back in a very difficult situation tonight when they return home. Lord, we don't have the answers, but you do. And I pray that every person that responded tonight, I know some of you came up here, that some of you guys came up here. If Debbie would have called for people that were in the third trimester of pregnancy, you would have come. And that's okay. That's okay. You're going to come for everything. But there are some of you that you have some very difficult situations. You know about them. The Lord knows about them. And what we want is we want the power of the Holy Ghost to be allowed to show up right in the big middle of the hell that some of you have to go into and live in because you don't have an unbelieving spouse. But Father's able to change that thing right now. And I when we grab a hold of something, I just have a problem letting it go until I feel like it's dead. You know, I just want to bust it in the head till it can't move. You know, that's how I deal with snakes, you know what I'm saying?
I love to see things get finalized. I when you reached hold and grabbed a hold of faith when you stepped up here, why not go ahead and let the finality of it once and for all come into your life? Why not let the finality of it, and the finality of it being that you are going to quit struggling with it, you're going to quit fighting it, you're going to just go ahead now and start fully living for Christ Jesus, fully living in every dimension of the realms of the Holy Ghost. And if your husband doesn't like you walking around the house praying in the Holy Ghost, just go ahead and let the Spirit of the Lord come with a stronger burst. I mean, however we got to break through this thing for you. We want it settled. So let's just agree tonight in the name of Jesus. Every body standing in this place, I want you to agree with me tonight that those who stood up here because of a situation, circumstances beyond their ability to begin to even think about dealing with, you could never even imagine a way out, that Father is going to work a miracle and He's going to break out in the situation. You know, I've had so many times people come to me and say, well, just tell me what to do. No, I'm not. Just tell me that show me where the exit is. I'm not. I'm going to show you where the rapture is. I'm going to show you where the catching away is. I'm going to show you how to let God step in this situation and absolutely flatten everything. Because come on now. Come on, I want you to start reaching out to see this thing. Everybody in this place, I want you to let the Spirit of the Lord cause you to begin to move in faith right now, to hook up with the needs of people that are up here, that have responded tonight, that are in this place, that need a solution, they need a resolve, they need to be strengthened by the Spirit right now in the name of Jesus. If you were in this, you would be on your face crying out to God. So I want you to go ahead and touch their situation, at least with a little bit of lip movement. Could I just see everybody's lips just moving just a little? Thank you. Okay. Amen. Father, we thank you right now that you hear our prayers and that you answer our prayer, that you hear us before we call. And right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, we break the back of this thing. In the name of Jesus. No more. Now let me say this. I have seen over and over again where Father's come with a miracle provision, but you got to cooperate. He's not going to make you praise. He's not going to make you rejoice. He's not going to make you believe. He's not going to make you worship. You're going to have to be willing to move with Him. You know, I've dealt with situations, even just recently, you won't even believe it, where people are just, they want me to pray deliverance over them, and I ask them, well, did you repent? And they were, no, I didn't repent. Did I need to? Yeah, because people are being taught now that sin has no consequence of death, they can't lose their salvation, and so sin has no consequence for death, you can't lose your salvation, why does anyone even need to ask for forgiveness? Where is there even a doctrine for forgiveness? Why was there any verse of scripture that say, if you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness? Why should there be any need for being washed or cleansed in the blood of Jesus? Why should there be a need for an advocate? Why should there be a need for an intercessor? So, I mean, there's a lot of things to break through on very basic levels with people. Listen, I'm telling you right now, sin has a consequence, and it's called death. There's a punishment for sin. Praise God that you and I can come under the conviction of the Holy Ghost, because we know the Word of God, and we've allowed the Word of God to work in us and recognize, wait a minute, what I've done is wrong. Father, forgive me. Lord Jesus, wash me, cleanse me in your blood. Holy Spirit, I don't want to live like this. Strengthen me, Lord, to do what's right. Now, Father's asking some of you in your situation to quit being overwhelmed with the circumstance. I hear so many people, they'll quote the verse of Scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God. But they don't even know what their weapons are. So it ain't going to help you very much. The Word of God takes preeminence in the weapons. The blood of Jesus. The power of the Holy Ghost. This wonderful realm of prayer that He produces. And I could go on, but I don't want to give you too many things because you'll forget the first thing. The Word. The Word. The Word. The Word of God. Just hallelujah. The Word. Anybody that came up here tonight, you have an assignment. You got to wake up in the morning, dance around, and worship God till you get happy. You got to praise Him. I mean, walk around the house like this. I promise you, the Lord will fix the thing. The Lord will fix it. The Father is not leaving you without provision. He's not allowing you to be tested about what you're able. I promise you. Don't compromise with the situation either. Compromise is the devil's game. I mean, it's just no compromise. Now, in the name of Jesus, let this thing be settled tonight. Let this thing be settled tonight. Let this thing be settled tonight. Some of you go make me think you need to have inner healing. No, you're not. You need to let this thing be settled. You're not. The reality of it is it just comes down to bringing a person to agreeing that God has done it. And that he's filled us with all provision to be happy. You know what happens? You know what I do when I'm not happy? I get filled. You know what I do when I'm not overwhelmed with thanksgiving and praise? I go ahead and just get filled. I said, Lord, fill me with the thanksgiving and the praise. Some of you might think that the Lord likes me more than you do. And that somehow maybe you've been convinced that you've been left out. But I promise you, that's a lie and you haven't. You haven't. I want to just get right behind what Debbie was saying and help you understand something. We have stood in the presence of the Lord and been overwhelmed by His love. And in that love, you don't remember you have any sin that anybody else sinned. You don't know that anybody ever did you wrong. You couldn't bring it to mind if they did. And everybody you love, they fall all over them, hug them, whatever, you know. And that's just scratching the surface of what Father exists in. That's just scratching the surface of what Jesus, how Jesus feels towards us, that which the Holy Ghost brings. I want you to get in this because you'll forget about the problems and the issues. Okay, would you guys quit decreasing? I mean, I got that word from the Lord today. I mean, it's a powerful word. Quit decreasing, would you please? And go ahead and get in the new covenant where you're dead, you don't live any longer, and you now live as Christ, and quit having some kind of other crazy, you know, bipolar spirituality, multi-personalities, hearing voices. Jesus, come on now. Jesus is the key. Hallelujah. Jesus is here. He's here. Hallelujah. You know, the worst thing I could imagine is that somebody came into this place tonight and you're allowing yourself to say no to Jesus. You're allowing yourself to say, I'm okay. I'm good enough. All I need is what I already got. When you meet Christ Jesus of the Bible, when you encounter the Holy Ghost that the Word of God testifies of, the last thing you will ever do for the rest of your life is say that you're good enough and what you have is good enough. Because when you get one taste of this realm, you get so hungry and so thirsty. And we just really hate to close the meeting tonight when the power of God is so present to absolutely transform your life. And in the name of Jesus Christ, I'm calling the fire of God down on you. You listen to me. You listen to me, every one of you. I'm calling the fire of God down on you. It's already too late. You stayed too long. I'm calling the fire of God down on you that will make you so uncomfortable until you scream out to God, "Oh God, come deliver me. Oh God, come save me." I had some people just recently come, they're standing in front of me, talking all kinds of nonsense. I said, "Okay, done, I'm done, 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 I'm done, okay, fine, okay, where I got you. Now, I call the fire of God down on you." They're like looking. Because I know what happens then, you know. You know, now they're going to go try to, you know, what happens, they're going to try to come find me. Because something's going on the inside. This is the Holy Ghost, divine discomfort. That will bring you to the Comforter. And you don't have to wait till tomorrow night or the next night. But I tell you right now, I'm going to give you some good news. Because I'm telling you right now, the powers of darkness cannot lie to you. Mind-blinding spirits are busted. Deceiving powers of darkness will no longer hold you into bondage. A fire of God is on you. I'm going to tell you right now, your drugs won't taste good no more. Your alcohol won't taste good no more. Your pornography won't look good no more. You're going to be restless and upset with everything about your life. Hallelujah. And I promise you, here's the good news. We're not moving. We will be right here. You can call on the name of Jesus no matter where you're at, but you just come here, we'll make sure that you touch heaven. Because listen, we want you to be uncomfortable now for a while rather than being uncomfortable throughout eternity in a place called hell. Listen to me. And I want to just deal with the spirit. I want to deal with the stinking spirit of Calvinism. You turn back the pages 80 years and you will not find one preacher who was Calvinist that believed in eternal security, that you could not lose your salvation over something. Okay, there's people here that believe this, that you believe in eternal security and you could never lose your salvation. But please listen to me. Up until about 80 years ago, you would have never found any preacher, Spurgeon, anybody, who would have said such a thing in the context that it's now been brought into over the past 30 years, that you can continue living in sin and practicing sin and be right with God. Because back then they would have simply said, "Oh, that's an evidence that you've never been born again." But now we've made it. Now we've erased that. And now we said, "Oh, we can't lose our salvation. Once saved, always saved." We continue on and we just continue with sin. And somehow there is no penalty for it. That is the quagmire of apostasy. It is the quagmire of the last day's deception. It gives you no defense to stand against the powers of darkness. And I'm going to tell you right now, you will spend an eternity in a place called hell. It is a real place. You can read about the second death, where every person who's dead will be raised to life again. They will be judged, whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And remember, the Lord Jesus Christ said in the Book of Revelation to the church, to individuals in the church, "Unless you repent, I will come and blot your name out of the Lamb's Book of Life, and I can take you back to Lucifer, who was a son of God, who rebelled against God, and he lost his salvation," because salvation only talks about our life in God and position and walk and oneness and union with God. And then Adam after him, well, angels after him, along with him, and Adam after him, and then all the way through the Bible to what Jesus said to the church in the Book of Revelation. So the nonsense doctrine that Satan has been speaking that would ultimately hold you in bondage, I break it off that. I break that thing off of you. I break it off of you. I break it off of you. Once you sit in rooms with people and they tell you that they wanted to commit suicide simply so they could go be with Jesus, so they could go to heaven, that is the ultimate place where that kind of doctrine leads you. And then you know that people end up in hell eternally in a place called the lake of fire, ultimately. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, not one person in this place will have that end. In the name of Jesus. And I pray that everybody in this place, that you will get a burden for the lost, and it will begin to burn in you like it burns in me, like it burns in us, to where we have such a burden over people's state of their soul, where we have such a determination to see the back of Satan and every one of his lies broken. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I mean, it's time for you to get out of the quagmire of your self-interest. Understand how to take up your cross, deny yourself. Amen. Deny your born-again self. Hey, you're listening to what I'm saying. Jesus denied himself, and it was nothing less than pure divine glory in himself. And he denied himself. So you need to understand how to take up your cross, deny yourself. Come follow him. Come imitate him, in other words. Come imitate him. Get out of the quagmire of your self-interest. Hallelujah. Prosatayalama. Hallelujah. Horrible. Yeah, yeah. Hallelujah. Now, you know what we're going to do? We're going to give you an opportunity to get real happy. Are you ready? I'm getting ready to allow you to participate with me in something that can get you so happy. Listen to me. It's going to get you in a miracle. Listen to me. We're gonna believe for a financial miracle for you tonight. Are you listening to me? Okay? We're going to believe for a financial miracle. And while we're believing for you to have a financial miracle, we're also going to believe for a financial miracle for Bob and Debbie Rester and the ministry. Okay? Okay? And so we can do both of them simultaneously. Because as you hook up in faith for the miracle of finances that God wants to get to you for your life, you get to hook up in faith with them, amen, by giving. So what happens is the Lord begins to work the greatest miracle of put it this way. Through the smallest act of obedience, God works the greatest miracles. He does. Salvation being the first one. And sets the preeminence and the precedence for it. So right now, I want everybody in this place, I want you to lift your hands towards heaven. And I want you to become overwhelmed by the power of the Holy Ghost. Every kind of emotion. Let me ask you again. Be energy. Be ministered. Ha. Be ministered. Bofra. Be yours. Be sin. Be of my. Be my own seat. Yeah. See no. Hallelujah. Now, just be overwhelmed by the prayer. Now, just go ahead and give yourself a little bit of joy, because some of you look like you need it. Go ahead and give yourself a little bit of joy. You don't know how to cooperate. Some of you don't know how to cooperate with joy after. Come on now. Go ahead and be joy. Go ahead, joy, for a few minutes. Amen. Amen. Go ahead, joy, for a few minutes. Just joy for a few minutes. Joy in the Holy Ghost for a few minutes. Hallelujah. Just go ahead, joy. Go ahead, joy. Just go ahead, joy in the Holy Ghost. Woo-hoo! Hallelujah. 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 You know, I can do that when I got guns being thrown in my face by people in the Middle East or in Asia. Yeah, I can see the Holy Ghost. He's always there. See, the kingdom of God is proven. People say, I'm in the kingdom of God. There's proof for it. Righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. Huh? So I can say, go ahead and flow. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. As the spirit of the Lord gives you utterance. As the spirit of the Lord gives you utterance. As the spirit of the Lord gives you utterance. Now, let me show you something. Same realm results in me being able to say temptation. No, I don't have nothing to do with you. People who don't do this, temptation takes them out. And so they only have to have a doctrine that, oh, we're going to sin more or less every day. You're going to sin more or less every day? You're going to die in your sins. You're going to spend an eternity in a place called hell. That's what the Bible says. You can have traditional, you can have philosophical, you can be a part of a philosophical tradition of the church, or you can be a part of the revelation of God's word. I'm just bringing it down to you. Because this is his threshing floor. He has his fan in his hand and he thoroughly purges it. We always be participating with Jesus and making sure that the wheat is separated from the chaff, because his winnowing fork is in his hand. He's going to throw you up in the air and we're going to see where you land. Are you landing on the side of the righteous or on the side of sinners? On the side of those who are holy or those who are unholy? And we're pleading with you tonight. I plead with you tonight, every one of you. Because there's people in this place, you are not right with God. And that's just how that is to it. And we want you to be right with God. And so if I can't get you persuaded, if I can't convince you tonight to come to Jesus, because we have seen you, we're going to begin to cry out to God to make you miserable. So miserable. Until you fall upon your knees and repent. Until you come under a Holy Ghost conviction. Somebody said, I've been having problems. Some witch doctor down in Tijuana, he did something. So I'm going to tell you right now, witch doctors in Tijuana and nothing. And nothing. Well, that stuff is broken easily. But what I'm praying on you, nobody can stop. I'm praying on you, Holy Ghost conviction that won't let up. In Jesus' name. Amen. And one day you're gonna thank me. You're gonna thank me. You're gonna thank me. Because you didn't come here by accident tonight. You didn't just come because somebody invited you and you decided to be convinced. You came here because God loves you so much. And he knew that we were going to put this on you like this. He knew what was going to happen. So he set you up. Don't blame me. He set you up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Prosana. Well, are you about ready to get even a greater blessing into your life? Are you about ready for even greater favor, greater supply of the Spirit into your life? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you excited about it? Hey, praise God. Is it holy? Is it worship? Is it something that you just enjoy doing as you worship the Lord through giving? So just come do it. Come worship the Lord. Come to the altar. You come to the altar. You come to the altar with the offering. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, I can barely stand in this place. The things of the Spirit so rich, so wonderful. I pray in Jesus' name, everyone who just get overwhelmed with. Just get overwhelmed with His goodness right now. Get overwhelmed with His goodness right now. Just get overwhelmed with His goodness right now. Just be overwhelmed with His goodness right now. Hallelujah. Robo si chitarra masse brevemente sciglino. Tonight, those of you that are standing at home, sitting at home, standing on the sidewalk, wherever you're at, watching on the web, or perhaps you're watching on YouTube, the power of God's present right where you're standing, right where you're sitting. The hand of God is extended towards you and He's touching you right now. Let Him overwhelm you with His goodness. Let Him take you over into this realm of the heavenlies that He ordained for you to live in. That Christ Jesus purchased and paid the price for you to be able to inherit. So just go ahead and inherit right now in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah! 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 Listen, everybody, would you stand with me? Hallelujah. Won't you just let the gifts of the Spirit function in you right now? Let the power of the manifestation of the power of God function in you, fill you up right now. Be ready for miracles, because God has commanded us and commissioned us to go everywhere, cast out devils, lay hands on the sick, to go raise the dead. God has commissioned us to preach the gospel with a demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. So you just go ahead and be receiving right now, so you can wake up in the morning. Leave out of here tonight. If you're gonna go to a restaurant, wherever, I mean, my goodness, find somebody that needs to. There's sick people everywhere. There is no shortage on sick people. Amen. Just go lay hands on them, command them to be healed. Just tell them. Go walk up to them, prophesy. Listen, just as you're walking towards them, you see them hurting. Say, listen, I have a word from heaven. God just sent me from heaven to you to declare to you that you are set free from your sin, and your sickness and disease has to be poured out of your body right now. That's what He told us to go do. Are you ready? I want to make sure everybody's ready to fulfill their assignment when they leave out of here tonight. You're supposed to go do the work of the ministry of Jesus. You're supposed to do what Jesus did. If you're really His disciple, you're going to follow Him. And that's exactly what He did. That's exactly what He did. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So be filled right now with the Holy Ghost. Just be filled. Just be filled. Field. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. And bless them in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.